Welcome to The Explainer. We're here to break down the big ideas. And today, we are tackling a huge one. The invisible forces that dictate the price of, well, everything. From your morning coffee to the car you drive, it all comes down to this hidden language. So, how are we going to do this? Well, we're going to borrow a really brilliant framework from a series of academic lectures by economist Michael Raviv. He uses these simple yet powerful thought experiments to make the complex world of markets make perfect sense. Let's walk through four of them.
But first, we need to get on the same page about one key idea. It's called market equilibrium. You know, think of it as the market's natural happy place. It's that perfect sweet spot where the amount of stuff for sale is exactly what people want to buy, and the price is stable. This is our baseline, our starting point for everything else.
Okay, so let's get into our first two scenarios. We're going to see what happens when that perfect balance gets totally knocked off kilter by a sudden change in supply, first in a good way, and then not so much.
So, on one side, we've got cucumbers. Imagine a new farming technology comes along that makes growing them super efficient. That's fantastic news for supply, right? And on the other side, we have coffee. Uh-oh. The cost of raw coffee beans, the one thing you absolutely need to make coffee, suddenly spikes. That is definitely bad news.
Let's stick with cucumbers for a sec. This new tech is a total game changer. All of a sudden, farmers can grow way more cucumbers without spending any more money. It's like a massive wave of new supplies about to crash into the market. And in economic terms, that wave literally pushes the supply curve to the right, forcing the market to find a new balance point.
So what happens when that wave hits? Well, with all those extra cucumbers lying around, sellers have to drop their prices to get them sold. And for us, the shoppers, this is amazing. There are more cucumbers to buy, and they're cheaper. It's a total win.
All right, now let's flip over to coffee. The price of raw beans goes up. See, this isn't a cool new technology. It's the exact opposite. Now, it costs more to produce every single cup. And that shock to the system forces the supply curve to shift to the left, which is just a fancy way of saying there's less coffee available at any given price.
And the result of that? With less coffee to go around, there's more competition for what's left. The price, you guessed it, goes up, and the total amount of coffee being sold actually goes down. Yep, that morning pick-me-up just got a little more painful for your wallet.
Now look at this. When you put them side by side, the relationship is just, it's perfectly clear. A boost in supply means lower prices and more stuff. A cut in supply means higher prices and less stuff. It's a perfect mirror image, two sides of the same supply coin.
Okay, so we've got a handle on what happens when producers change things. But what about when the change comes from us, the buyers? Let's see how a shift in what we want creates its own ripples in the market.
To really get this next part, we need to know what complementary goods are. It's simple, really. They're just things that people use together. You know, like printers and ink cartridges. Or, in this next example, cars and fuel. They're tied at the hip.
All right, here's the next thought experiment for you. Imagine, for some reason, people all over the country are suddenly buying way more fuel. What does that single fact tell us about a totally separate market, the market for cars?
Well, think about it. People don't buy fuel just to stare at it, right? You need a car to use it. So, a huge spike in fuel sales is a giant flashing sign that the demand for cars is also going up. And that collective desire for more cars pushes the whole demand curve to the right.
And here's the really interesting result. Because more people are clamoring for cars, car makers can start charging more. And at the same time, to meet all this new interest, they start making and selling more cars. Now, notice how different this is? When demand changes, both the price and the quantity go up together.
Okay, time for our final scenario. And this one is a bit of a mind-bender. It's a special case, an exception that seems to break all the rules we just learned. It's about products we feel like we just have to have, no matter what.
Let's ask a pretty wild question. What if there's a product out there that's so necessary, or maybe so addictive, that people will buy the exact same amount of it, even if the price goes through the roof? What happens then?
Well, economists have a name for that. It's called perfectly inelastic demand. If you were to draw it on a graph, it wouldn't be a curve at all. It would just be a straight, vertical line. It means demand is totally rigid. It does not bend or break, no matter what the price does.
So let's use the cigarette market as our example. Let's pretend for a moment that demand from smokers is perfectly inelastic. They're going to buy their one pack a day, come hell or high water. Now, just like with our coffee example, the cost of a raw material, tobacco, suddenly gets more expensive. Supply shifts to the left.
But watch this. The outcome is totally different from coffee. Because the quantity people want to buy cannot change, the entire shock of the supply cost gets absorbed by the price. Producers just pass on every single penny of that higher cost. The price skyrockets, but the number of packs sold doesn't budge one bit.
Whew. Okay, so we've walked through cucumbers, coffee, cars, and cigarettes. What does it all mean? How can we actually use this stuff to make sense of the world and the headlines we see every day?
Let's boil it all down. First, technological progress is almost always a win for your wallet. It usually means lower prices. Second, if it costs more to make something, you can bet that extra cost is getting passed on to you. Third, we saw that different markets, like cars and fuel, are way more connected than they seem. And finally, some products just don't play by the normal rules, usually because of addiction or absolute necessity.
And that's really the point of all this. This framework gives you a new way to look at the world. So next time you're at the store and see the price of something is shot up, you can stop and ask yourself, wait, is this a supply thing or a demand thing? And once you start asking that question, you start to understand the hidden language of the market all around you.